In 1939, doctors began experimenting with cutting people's brains in half. It's not as crazy as it sounds, though. In fact, up until recently, severing the corpus callosum, the bundle of nerves that connects the two halves of your brain, was used to treat epilepsy. But more than curing epilepsy, the experiments that came later upended our understanding of human consciousness. So much so that it has profound implications today on the rise of multi-agent cognition architectures in machine intelligence. But we're getting ahead of ourselves. To really understand any of this, you first need to meet Joe.
I know the left hemisphere and right hemisphere now are working independent of each other, but you don't notice it.
Joe has surgery 7 years before this was filmed to sever his corpus callosum to treat an extreme form of epilepsy. Your brain, assuming you're a human, is a marvel of duality. Two hemispheres each command half of your body, the right side controlling the left and the left controlling the right. Dr. Gazzaniga's experiments on Joe after his surgery aimed to unravel the mysteries of his split brain.
You ready? Look right at the dot. Right.
He asked Joe to focus on a dot so that only his left eye would see one side of the dot and his right eye the other side. While many brain functions are bilateral with both hemispheres involved, some tasks lean heavily on one hemisphere. The right hemisphere is specialized for spatial judgments, for example, while the left hemisphere has the ability to describe perceptions in words.
What did you see? So just close your eyes and draw with your left hand. Just let it go.
Only Joe's right brain saw the saw, but it can't speak. So he can't name what he saw, but he can draw it with his left hand, the hand controlled by his right hemisphere.
Nice, what's that? Saw? Yeah, what'd you see? Hammer? What'd you draw that for?
I don't know.
When we speak with our mouths, our assumption is we are speaking as one thing, one conscious self. And Joe seems sincere in his words, but simultaneously, his hands disagree with himself. In the 1960s, Dr. Sperry performed similar experiments on a split-brain patient who was shown a bell. The patient's language-dominant hemisphere created a justification for drawing the bell, often inventing a story rather than acknowledging a disjointed experience. Repeated experiments over the years continue to suggest the same unsettling conclusion about our consciousness and our cognition. The human brain contains multiple independent cells or agents that are competing for control at any given moment.
These agents, these processes can carry on a vast number of activities outside of our conscious awareness. Even though that goes on, there's some final stage or some final system, which I happen to think is in the left hemisphere, that pulls this, all of this information together into a theory. It has to generate a theory to explain all of this, all of these independent elements. And so, and that theory becomes our particular theory of ourself and of the world.
On October 25th, 2006, 16 doctors are ready to deliver conjoined twins at British Columbia's Children's Hospital. It will be a marathon operation, as these babies are extremely rare. They are conjoined at the brain.
They can sit there and not say anything to each other, and all of a sudden, one will pop up and grab something to eat for the other one. Like, there's no words being spoken between the two of them at all, and they know exactly what the other one wants.
The two girls have separate brains and personalities, but their brain stems are connected by a thalamic bridge, like a high-speed fiber optic cable. They can see out of each other's eyes, they can taste the food each other eats. They have a shared conscious experience, yet two independent personalities. Mom demonstrates by covering Krista's eyes while placing a toy in front of Tatiana.
Krista, what's mommy holding?
piggy?
That's right, Mommy's holding the piggy.
It's like you've got two independent television sets, okay? But that there's a cable that's running between the two of them. And even though you can watch channel 2 over here and you can watch channel 4 over here, every once in a while, this one can turn on the station that this one is watching and tune into it.
Understanding the nature of consciousness has very concrete and profound implications on the relationship between biological and artificial intelligence.
I actually started out when I was a grad student, like 30 plus years ago, working on neural networks back in the early 90s in Doug Hofstadter's AI lab. And then I kind of got distracted by thinking about consciousness.
From world models to theory of mind, there is a lot that we could talk about in this incredibly deep field of consciousness research. But I want to focus in on this very specific idea of agency.
If you ask me, the feature that these many current language models lack that seems most crucial is some kind of unified agency. It looks like these language models can take on many different personas, like actors or chameleons. Yeah, you can get Lambda to say it's sentient, but you can just as easily get it to say it's not sentient. You can get it to simulate a philosopher or an engineer or a politician. They seem to lack stable goals and beliefs of their own, which suggests a lack of a certain unity.
Agency, in a general sense, refers to the capacity of an individual or an entity to act independently and make their own free choices. It refers to the recognition in an entity that their thoughts and actions directly lead to the outcomes in their world. Agency is something that appears very early in human development. This experiment captures the moment where an infant realizes that their movements affect the world around them, which creates a drive for them to experiment and learn more. For example, during the tethering, the researchers noticed that stillness punctuated the bursts of kicking activity. This seems to indicate that the babies were exploring how their actions or their non-action played into their ability to control the things around them. This requires multiple parts of the baby's brain working together. The visual cortex has to coordinate with the movement circuits, which has to coordinate with the baby's ability to plan and perform experiments to learn on the fly. It's a lot of complicated stuff going on in there. In order for this agency to form, in order for any of this to work, all the different parts of you, the different structures in your brain and your body, have to decide that they are better off working together as a unified, coherent whole than they are working apart. An emergent entity and experience forms from the interaction of multiple independent parts. And there's ample evidence for this phenomenon of emergence all throughout nature. For instance, the mitochondria that lives in every cell of multicellular organisms, the powerhouse of the cell, if you will. Oh, and I will. That came from two cells who did very different things, getting together billions of years ago and deciding, hey, maybe we should team up. Maybe one day in a few billion years, we can create some humans or something.
These capabilities are often talked in the AI field about as agents.
So, are you an AI living in the Matrix? Probably, but I would argue it doesn't really matter. What matters more is you realizing the agency within yourself. These core ideas of emergence are beginning to play out at higher and higher levels now.
We believe that if you give people better tools, they will do amazing things.
OpenAI made waves at their first ever developer conference this week, unleashing agent swarms upon the world. Using their new GPT Builder tool, anyone can use a friendly interface to create intelligent assistants trained on whatever data you want. These agents have access to thousands of tools, including the ability to create more agents. But these agents, they can't really do anything that useful unless there is a framework or an architecture for them to be able to work together. There needs to be a way for them to share a common goal. And that, my dear friend, is where you come in.
We believe that AI will be about individual empowerment and agency at a scale that we've never seen before. And that will elevate humanity to a scale that we've never seen before either.
As incredibly advanced and mind-blowing as this technology is, GPT-4 won't do anything until you ask it to. It has no will, drive, or coherent goals, as far as we know. It needs that initial spark, that initial prompt where you tell it what to do. You give it a coherent goal and direction. And in that sense, once these agents become ubiquitous and a part of our everyday lives, they will become literal extensions of ourselves. They'll become so ingrained into the way we think and communicate with each other that it will start to make more sense to not refer to these collections of entities as individual parts, but as components of a larger, coherent whole.
As intelligence gets integrated everywhere, we will all have superpowers on demand.
We'll become cyborgs with access to an extensive global network of intelligence and knowledge. But the story doesn't end there, because at some point, this intelligence network of the planet Earth will become so dense that it will make more sense to talk about the Earth itself as a single coherent entity with behavior and experience than it is to talk about all the individual agents that make it up. Humanity is evolving into a planetary intelligence. But if we want to experience that level of conscious awareness, it necessarily means that we as a society have to decide that we are better off working together than apart, just as our ancestors did billions of years ago. That means you have to reclaim the agency that you probably lost long ago. You have to break the patterns of tribal thinking and the ideas of scarcity, holding you captive in a world where you no longer belong. Life can be full of passion and purpose if you allow it to be.
You have to let it all go, Neo. Fear, doubt, and disbelief.
There has never been a time more ripe in human history for you to harness the incredible power and agency available within yourself and at your fingertips. It's time for you to recognize the power within yourself and use it.
They can do things that nobody else can do.
Talk about teamwork.
Yeah.
It's the definition of it, isn't it?
Oh yeah, definitely.